Thank you for the rains that we've received. Lord, we just thank you for addressing our every
County is pleased to present.
The fathers have come to you now, Lord. I do just lift up
the Alamance County Commissioners.
Men and women, Lord, that are fighting abroad for our freedom. Lord, we just pray that you just be with them and keep them safe and bring them back safe to us. Father, I do pray now for this meeting. Lord, I just pray that you'd guide and direct us as we make the decisions. And Lord, may they be decisions that are favorable in your eyes. These things I do pray in your precious name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Please stand for the pledge of allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have several guest public speakers for tonight, and I just remind our public speakers for time's sake, we do allow 3 minutes. And first on our list is Mr. Tony Cox.
It's a good thing that we have speakers. Things is picking up around here. You know, I mulled it over in my mind, and I said, you know, I'd love to see the transcript, the audio, video, the sworn testimony of God in the court case that you spoke about. Preamble to the Constitution, in God we trust, God's a good thing. No doubt about it. I thank God that the Alamance County High Impact Land Use and Polluting Industries Ordinance is gone. Because a lot of people got hurt under the spirit of the law. But, you know, spirits of the law is a bad thing. Why can people not follow the law? Why do people, under the pretense of God, support and condone the things that the bad do? I hear today or yesterday about how bad women are treated in Iraq. Women are treated bad here too. It ain't just a rat. It's amazing to me, under the pretense of God. This woman right here, Deborah Prince, she suffered. They prayed that night. They did, they prayed. Deborah Prince, it's a lie. Multiple complaints, it's a lie. One. After a site inspection, you're guilty of a Class 3 misdemeanor. Boy, here's where he got mad. You remember me telling you about how people get mad at me? I told this boy. You can see it right here. Let's make it clear here under the law. Class 3 misdemeanor. That's a letter to Deborah Prince and Tony Cox. Tony Cox ain't never been charged with nothing. Nan Vaughn made a comment about the spirit of the law in a newspaper article talking about your county attorney. Nan Vaughn said that I was running an illegal junkyard on my girlfriend's property and that I never tried to find out about license and permit. That's a lie. I got the papers. It's a lie. Under God, spirit of the law, Constitution. I was going to talk about how these industries now are coming into Alamance County because this is gone. That's what we found out about in the.
Thank you, Mr. Cox.
You said if I brought cash down here, that I could get more time.
But I will say we thank you for your $200.
Thank you very much.
It's only gave $200 to those who know to the 9/11 or more, and we appreciate that. Thank you. All right, next we have Lost Souls Ministry.
Some bikers association, Alamance County chapter.
Davis, I guess. Are you gonna do it?
Lost Souls Ministry.
Well, I'm here with concern. I'm the chaplain for the area.
So you're not speaking to public comment.
I don't think y'all really want me to.
All right, Bones. All right, so you're on our agenda, sir, that we'll cover later. Did you?
We're receiving a proclamation.
Okay. So we'll just go on to the next one. Jim Hodgson. Thank you. Welcome, Jim.
Thank you very much. And I appreciate the opportunity, public servants, of speaking for a few moments to you tonight. First time I've ever been at a commissioner's meeting. It doesn't look exactly like it does on television, but that's okay. A couple of weeks ago, I was in a restaurant. Someone handed me a newspaper. I don't read the newspapers that much due to the work in my ministry. But this time I did. And I turned around to the gentleman who handed it to me. I said, "You know something? There's some good news in this newspaper for change." Front page. The vote that you took to put plaques on the buildings in Alamance County that says, "In God we trust." Now, the person I said that to said, "Well, you know, someone came to the county commissioners and enticed them or asked them to do that." I said, that's not the point, because they didn't have to do it, but they did. You see, I'm concerned this day and age with what I refer to as pussyfoot politicians that skirt around issues like that when it's time to take a stand. I thoroughly enjoyed, Mr. Boswell, your comment that was quoted in the newspaper, sir. God bless you. When you said, as you see Christians and people across the ocean being persecuted and killed for standing up for what they believe is right, and I think this tells we do need God. Yes, we do. I'm pleased to say that in my speaking in throughout the world through my ministry, Worker Ministries out of Elon, I have an opportunity to come on the platform with many individuals, and next week I'm pleased to be in Pasadena Convention Center speaking. I always love to have a role model, someone that you can point to and say, "Now that's the way it ought to be in government. That's the way it ought to be." And I'm pleased to be able to stand in Pasadena and point to the county commissioners in my county and say, "They stood up for what was right." And God bless you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
And I will tell you, gentlemen, also, that there's something I do for you each day, and I do it for this gentleman sitting here each day who is the sheriff of this county that I worry about. I pray for you each day. May God continue to bless you as you do the work for the people.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Any commissioners' responses?
Thanks for those comments.
Well, thank you for those kind comments, Jim, and thank you for your prayers, sir. Thank you. All right. Next on the agenda is approval of the agenda. Do I have a motion for approval of the agenda?
I so move.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Consent agenda. Members, any members have items that they'd like to see taken out of the consent agenda? Okay. With that being said, do I have a motion for approval of the consent agenda?
I move we approve the consent agenda.
I'll second that.
Motion second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. All right, moving on to item number 7-1, special presentation, the Alamance County Marine Corps League. I'd like to welcome Mr. Wayne Lottman. Mr. Lottman.
Chairman Engel, Commissioners Bird, Boswell, and Smith, it's my pleasure to be here representing the Marines and Navy Corpsmen of the last Corporal Allen D. Lamb Detachment here in Alamance County. We recognize that as veterans, we've had a lot of recognition. We have the wall commemorating those that have cashed in their check up the street, the Veterans Park in Mebane. And when we saw that you approved to have a monument for the innocent lives that were lost in 9/11, and also to recognize our brothers and sisters that are here on the homeland, the firemen, the EMTs, and the policemen, we thought it was prudent that we recognize them, and we want to donate $100 to that monument. And I hope that the community will step up and support that and maybe raise more money in what you're looking for. And thank you very much for allowing me to address you tonight.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Robinson. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, Mr. Lawton. And also, you will receive that invitation when we have our service that day, once the memorial's finished, sir.
We appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you. All right. Next, we have item 7-2 is the Motorcycle Awareness Month proclamation. Dave, look. Dave, I'm going to come down. Members, if you had the opportunity to look over the proclamation, do I have a motion that we approve this proclamation?
I'll make that motion.
All right. I'll second. I'll second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. All right. I'm going to come down and read this today.
Y'all can do a little dance there.
Whereas motorcycle riding is a popular form of recreation and transportation for thousands of citizens across North Carolina and the United States, and whereas North Carolina has over 193,000 registered motorcycles and over 400,000 licensed drivers who have either a motorcycle endorsement or a motorcycle learner's permit. Whereas it is important that the citizens of North Carolina be aware of motorcycles on our roadways and recognize the importance of motorcycle safety and of sharing the roadways. And whereas the safe operation of a motorcycle is enhanced through a combination of rider training and experience, good judgment, and the knowledge of traffic laws and licensing requirements. And whereas several organizations, such as the Alamance County Concerned Bikers Association, along with the North Carolina Motorcycle Safety Education Program, and other state and local motorcycle clubs and riding social clubs, are committed to increasing the safe operation of motorcycles by promoting rider safety education programs. And whereas Motorcycle Safety Awareness Month is designed to increase public awareness about motorcycles and to encourage their safe and proper use among motorcycle riders. Now, therefore, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners do hereby proclaim the month of May 15th as Motorcycle Safety Awareness Month in Alamance County, North Carolina, and urge all citizens to call this observance to the attention of all our citizens. This is the 20th day of April, 2015, and signed by all of our county commissioners and also our clerk to the board, Ms. Frank. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
And I'd like to thank all the board members, too. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Ms. Thanks for your advocacy.
Yes, sir.
Keeping us safe.
We try our best.
That's it.
Thank you. All right. Next is Mike Williams. Is Mike here setting a public hearing request for me for May the 4th meeting? Hey, Mr. Williams.
Good evening. I'm Mike Williams, president of the Alamance County Chamber of Commerce, and you know, good things come in threes, and tonight is one of those opportunities. April 20th is my mother's birthday. April 420 was my Boy Scout troop number, and 420 is when I get to ask you to set a date for a public hearing to begin a process for what can be a significant economic development project in Alamance County. I'm asking here tonight for you to set a date for May the 4th, I believe it is, Monday, May the 4th, for an economic development incentives public hearing for a company called MGP Retail Consulting LLC. That is the corporate name that is being used. It's not necessarily maybe the marketing or branding name, but that's the corporate name of the entity that we would be dealing with. So I would ask for you to set the date of May the 4th for that hearing.
So moved. And that's MJ.
M as in Mac.
JT.
GT. Uh-huh. And P.
Okay.
MGP Retail Consulting LLC.
All right. Thank you. And it appears that the fact that all those things happened on that date, the 20th, that we may have a big company ahead.
420, well, that's the start of it. Anyway, tonight's the start of the process.
Well, that's good news. And Judge, thank you for your motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you, sir.
See you May 4th.
Thank you. This is
Monday.
All right, next item number four is a request for financial support for railroad infrastructure expansion project. Mr. Honeycutt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Board. Brian Hall with SAMIT is here this evening and wanting the county to help participate in the extension of a road or a rail spur in the NCIC Park. This is a joint project with the Department of Transportation. City of Mebane has been committed to it, and Alamance County Foundation has been committed to it. So a lot of different partners that we're looking at to extend the rail spur, and hopefully that will bring us some additional projects in the future. And I'll turn it over to Brian.
Welcome, Brian.
Thank you, Craig. Thank you. Set a couple of boards up here so you guys can see. This is just another version of what's on the PowerPoint there.
Mr. Chairman, members of the Commission, thank you for the opportunity to be here. We appreciate you guys' continued support of our efforts with our industrial park, which I hope you're all familiar with. It's 600 acres in Mebane on the east side of the county. We've been at work there since 2001. A couple of facts, a couple of statistics about our park since 2001. We've created $134 million in tax base since 2001. Shown here with the companies that are represented in the park, many of which you guys helped support us win. Good jobs, good companies, good manufacturers and distributions. There's over 1,100 jobs in the park today. We've developed 220 of our 600 acres. That means we've got about 380 left to go. The northern border of the park is strategic as we see it. It borders the rail line that goes right through the center of the county, right with 70. That rail line that we all know and love. The reason that Cambro Manufacturing came to this county was because of that rail line. Their manufacturing process, that was a $30 million project that located here last summer. Their manufacturing process, for them, it was a competitive advantage to receive raw materials over the rail, that raw material being resin, in a rail car. It's more cost effective than getting it by truck. That's why they picked North Carolina Industrial Center. That's why they picked Alamance County for their site. And so at that time we said, Cambro, we'll get you a rail spur. We'll figure out a way to get the railroad into the industrial park. And so we've got that commitment. We'll honor that commitment with Cambro. But as we've gotten into the engineering of it, we recognized and said, maybe there's a better way to do this. Maybe we can create competitive advantage for the rest of our park based on the way we design this rail spur. Now, so by example, we could pull a single rail spur into the park. That rail spur would be very similar to what you see at the top of the page there, which Southern States has. If you look at the beginning of where that yellow highlight starts on the north end on the main line, just south of that yellow highlight where it starts, you can see a little curve there. That's Southern States' single-user rail spur. That's a jointed rail spur. It's a light-gauge rail. What we're proposing, we could do that for Cambro. We could do the exact same thing, but we think that's also an opportunity. We're going to put a mainline switch on the mainline railroad track, and we can extend a mainline railroad that's a heavier gauge welded track that can serve multiple users. We can pull that off of the mainline across Holt Street and into the industrial park as a mainline service for future rail users that we could attract into the rest of the park, the other 380 acres that we've got to develop shown there. Meanwhile, Cambro can still have its single-user rail spur that we'll pull off of there and provide to Cambro. But this mainline track, we think, is a competitive advantage. Let me explain to you why I think that. So the whole park is a certified site. You guys are familiar with the term certified site. It's a process we go through for the state to give us a stamp of approval. It says it's a great site for manufacturing for industrial users. NC Access is the website that the State Department of Commerce uses to manage all the sites across the state. So in researching that website, one of the options that you can select is does your site have rail service? Is it a certified site? Does it have rail service? If we were to put in this infrastructure as shown, the highlighted portion there on the map, we'd be the only site in the county with that level of rail service as a certified site. Looking in a broader spectrum, we'd be the only site in the Triad region with that level of rail service as a certified site. Looking across the whole state with that level of rail service, we'd be one of three, the other two being in the Triangle. So from a competitive advantage standpoint, a customer, a user, a manufacturer that's looking at our state, while they may be looking at others and has a need for rail service, we'd be one of three. We think that's incredibly important for attracting the manufacturing users that we like, the manufacturing users like Cambro that have a competitive advantage by receiving their raw materials over the railroad as opposed to truck. So this rail project costs in total about $1.5 million is what the total cost of that rail serve project is. Let me explain to you, we've got many partners in the park, you guys being one. Let me explain to you where the funding sources are coming from and why we're requesting you guys' support and help here. The North Carolina Railroad, NCR, the owner of the rail corridor across our state, they're the biggest contributor. They're contributing $750,000 to this cause because they agree with the analysis of the competitive advantage. They think it's a competitive advantage, and they're interested in driving rail traffic on their rail lines. They're contributing $750,000. Samet Corp, we're contributing $280,000. North Carolina Department of Transportation has a rail access grant program. Mac Williams helped us apply for that. NCDOT is providing $200,000 worth of support. Mac Williams Economic Development Foundation that he supports is providing $100,000 in support of this. The City of Mebane approved last Monday night support of $100,000. That leaves us $100,000 short of our need to put in this mainline rail spur, which is why I'm before you tonight, to ask for your support and $100,000. Help us close the gap. The project is fully engineered. It's fully designed. It's fully permitted. We can move to the field immediately. We think it's about a three-month project to build this. Essentially, the railroad is their own contractor. We don't build railroads. The railroad builds their own railroads. And so essentially, we're paying the railroad to construct this mainline switch, crossing over Holt Street into our industrial park, providing not only service for Cambro, but the opportunity that you see there for the heart, really the heart of NCIC, the balance of that 300 acres to attract an industrial rail serve user. Just by way of simple example, I spend about half my life in that industrial park working to attract users every day. Mac will vouch for that. Mr. Samet says he doesn't care which 12 hours of the day I'm out there. As long as I'm out there half a day, he's okay with it. But to be able to stand a customer on a piece of property and explain to them, well, yes, we can bring the railroad through the park over there, across Holt Street, and down by this other building, and then across the creek. And yeah, eventually we'll get to your site. It's one thing. But to be able to walk them out there and stand them on the tracks, stand them on the rail and point to it and say, you can have this site here with this railroad, helps us win projects. Taking the risk out of the economic development process helps us be successful. And so I ask for your support tonight to help us take some risk and attract the next rail user in our industrial park.
So moved.
Thank you, Judge. Thank you, Brian. Did you have anything further to add, Mr. Singer, in terms of?
What we were looking at with respect to funding was do this over a four-year period, and that would be $25,000 a year for a four-year period, and that was agreeable to Sam as well.
Yeah.
And you saw an email in your packet from the City of Mebane where they committed $25,000 this year and $75,000 next year. I was looking at it as a budget item.
I think it would be better to stretch it. Those buildings that are proposed, I guess, is it ready for a building?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So the ground's dirt's ready.
It is, yeah.
Put a railroad in front. You
yes,
can bring in some people, right?
I hope so. I work every day to do that.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
I don't know this. Maybe others don't either, but does Samet own all the property in that industrial park?
So we have an agreement. That whole 600 acres was the legacy Ray family farm, and if you guys will recall, when Mercedes was looking at Alamance County, this is actually the exact same rail line, rail corridor that Mercedes was going to bring the railroad in to serve their auto manufacturing plant. And so we have a long-term agreement with the Ray family as they've hired us after the Mercedes plant went away. They hired us to continue to develop their property as they wanted to create jobs for Alamance County and leverage their 600-acre farm to build this industrial park. And so we have a long-term agreement with the Rays.
So I have another ignorant question. does it, the trains have to come, be coming from the east in order to access that, or maybe they can be going west and then back in?
Correct, either way. Yes, sir.
Any further questions?
Well, we got a motion. I'll second the motion.
Well, we have a motion and a second, and $25,000 per year.
Per year.
Is that, will that timeline be satisfactory? That won't delay necessarily? Because we already lost one company, I understand, according to your letter, that went to what, Gaston County, was it?
Right, that was sort of alluding to my earlier story. You know, that where you see the two buildings there that are rail served, I stood in that very soybean field and tried my best to explain to them how the railroad could get there. They went to Gaston County. And I think the headline of that article was rail access is what attracted them to Gaston County.
Very good.
But the commitment over the four-year period will be satisfied.
Yes, sir.
All right, gentlemen, we do have a motion and a second that we provide $100,000 at $25,000 over a four-year period to Samet for railroad infrastructure. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, next we have Mr. Brian Baker. Brian's here. Asking for approval to apply for Impact Alamance grant. Welcome, Brian.
Good evening, Commissioners. Commissioners, I come before you today to request permission on behalf of the Recreation and Parks Department to apply to Impact Alamance for a grant in the amount of $35,000. The grant would help us make significant improvements to the Eli Whitney Community Center, and in particular the playground equipment out front. We've talked about this recently. As you know, the stuff we have there, the equipment is old and needs to be replaced. We are seeking funds to basically replace what we have in our budget process, and that would help us come back with exactly what we have. But we saw this opportunity that Impact Alamance was presenting to apply for some funds to make a real improvement there. Impact Alamance is interested in community development through healthy eating, active living, and this fits right into the kind of things they're hoping to do. So this is a great opportunity for us to upgrade our facilities. There's no match required by the county. The Recreation and Parks Commission has reviewed this and recommended approval.
So moved.
Second.
Any questions? We do have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Uh-huh.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you.
Thank you.
Quick tonight, Jeff.
Well, thank you. Get on home.
All right. Next, we have Ms. Hook, established new positions for DSS.
Commissioners, good evening.
Good evening.
The Personnel Committee met a few weeks ago to discuss a request from DSS to establish three new positions. These positions would be in the Child Welfare Services area. They would be a foster care adoption social worker three position, a social worker three position that would work with kids transitioning out of foster care, and then a child welfare supervisor three. The funding for these positions is going to come from new recurring state allocations. And the reason that we're asking for the positions now is that they've just received the money. That's why they're asking for them now instead of waiting for the new budget. So they've received $190,000, which more than covers these three positions. It is recurring funds. The Personnel Committee met, talked about this, and they have made a recommendation to ask the board to approve these three positions.
Since it's my committee, I'm going to move to approve.
Thank you, sir.
And I will second. Any further comments? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Next item number 8, Alamance County Network and Data Update. Did I pass one?
Yeah,
I'm sorry. Well, it's the same. We got the same guy up for both.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. Good evening. I'm here with this item about the jail roof repairs. I'm going to ask you to approve total $267,760 from appropriated fund balance for us to replace the roof on the old part of the Alamance County Jail. In early April, staff from the jail, county maintenance, and county management met with Mr. Rick Noon, as a consulting engineer, not with any roofing companies, an engineer, to help us determine what the best solution was to fix the roof on the old jail. As you know, it's leaking. looking pretty significantly into the administrative offices and into the cell blocks, needs to be replaced. We wanted to come up with the best option. We looked at several different options for that roof, and we came to terms on the best option, long-term and maintenance-friendly. And what we are recommending to you tonight, we will do is remove the existing roofing system down to the structural concrete deck. We'll install a 2-ply modified bitumen membrane, which will be applied directly to the concrete deck. We'll also lay a 1/2-inch thick drainage composite filter fabric. We will reinstall a minimum of 3-inch thick insulation boards. We hope to be able to save some cost by using the insulation boards that are there now. There's no guarantee that they will all be there and all be sufficient to use, but we certainly hope that they will be. We'll also install some filter fabric and distribute clean washed number 4 river rock ballast over the top of the roof. What we've required from the winning bidder is that the process be done in such a way that we'll be eligible to receive a 20-year warranty on both the materials and the labor for the roof. And our projected start date is May 18th of this year, and we're hopeful that the project should not exceed 120 days from the time we award. The price range of this project, when we started soliciting bids, we estimated it to be between $30,000 and $500,000, so we used the informal bid process. We solicited bids from 9 companies directly. We direct solicited 9 companies. We also posted this project on the county's website under a section that we are calling current bid solicitation. So it was out there for consumption. We also direct solicited. We received bids from 4 companies, and we opened them on April 16th at 2 o'clock p.m. The lowest price we received, was from the company AAR of North Carolina. The price they quoted was $238,760. What we're asking you to consider tonight is to fund this project using AAR of North Carolina as the awarded contractor for $238,760. We're also asking that you approve a $24,000 project contingency. It's approximately 10% in the event we run into other damage or other problems during the project. We're also asking the board to approve $5,000 for Rick Noon's consulting services as he helped us come up with this bid spec and the final project solution. So the total we're asking the board to consider funding for the jail roof replacement project is $267,760 from appropriated fund balance. So that would be for the work, $24,000 contingency, which if not used will revert back to appropriated fund balance, and $5,000 for the consulting service. At this time, I'll be happy to field any questions. Also have Richard Hill from the County's Facility Department here. If you have any questions.
Where is this company from?
Kernersville. We had several from Kernersville, Raleigh, bid on this project.
Have we ever used them before?
I'm not aware of using AAR before, but
back about 5 years ago when we replaced the roofs, they did the one on this building and civil next door and did a very good job.
So we've had experience with them before.
And the second bidder there was, I believe, Allied, who did the HSC roof. So two very competent companies.
Is 20 years about the maximum warranty that is common in these kinds of roofs?
Yes, sir.
Bob, I don't plan to be here for that.
If they get wet, then it usually is
We feel like this is the best solution for the jail roof, and we know the importance of what the business goes on over there. We know that the state inspects that facility, and right now they know the roof is leaking. They know we're also in the process of trying to get that fixed. So I think they've been willing to work with the sheriff's office to work with us as we go through this process.
Is any idea about reusing, you said possibly using some of the insulation board that's on there?
Yes, the quote from the manufacturer is assuming that we will be able to use it all. We're certainly hopeful. We've been up and looked at it. We think we will be able to. There's a chance that some of it might be damaged or unable to use, but they'll try to reuse as much of that as they can.
Well, except for the contingency and the consultant's fee, this is consistent with what we talked about last time.
Yes. Yeah.
It is. Further questions? So moved.
I'll second it.
I have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you, Brian. And move on to item 8, Alamance County Network and Data Update.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
This report that you have, that you should have gotten in your packet, there's no action from the board required. This is an update to let you know, try to give you an overview of the server outage incident that we experienced back in January. report details information about that event occurred on January 26th of 2015. At that day, our network failed due to a scheduled update. So we had scheduled an update to the server, server area network. It failed. The network was down. The county's network was down from the afternoon of January 26th through the entire workday of January 27th. The reason the update went bad, there was improper code used, and it caused an error, took down the storage area network. There was pretty widespread fallout from this event. There were some factors that contributed to that. As we got into this process, we really started right off the bat trying to find out what happened, what was the long-reaching impact. We found that the county's network data backups currently take a very long time to do, days to do a complete backup. We create a tremendous amount of data at Alamance County, as you can well imagine. So it takes a very long time to back that up. And when this failure occurred, we had to revert to the last backup that had been done, which was over that weekend. So we lost that entire Monday's worth of data. A contributing factor to this was scheduling the update for a weekday. That was not a best management practice. It would have been better to do that on a weekend. County is 24/7. We're operating all the time. We're creating data all the time. But the data creation load is less on the weekends. It would have been better to do it then. Also, contributing factors include the fact that county departments were not aware of the update. So they didn't have the opportunity to prepare for it or to possibly retain things like hard copies that they would have lost in the event of an update. Another contributing factor we found was communication between MIS and the county departments was not well coordinated. During the event, after the event, we could have done a better job communicating with the departments and letting them know what was going on. And also, it became apparent to us, the public were unaware that their calls and emails were also affected by this outage. So if you called and left a voicemail or you sent an email to a county employee, you were not able, employees weren't able to get back with you. So if we didn't have a way or consider how to let the public know that was going on. So you can look in the report and see some of the results of the incident. What I listed in that report is not every single result. It was just too much to try to list it all. I tried to just focus on the significant things that happened during the event. We had two things that happened. One was data loss, right? So somebody creates a document and they save it. That was lost. We also had operational problems. Because of this storage area network went down, we also lost the ability to do things like the sheriff being able to, his officers being able to log into the computer in their car. So that's not data related, it's more operational, but extremely important, obviously. In fact, the emergency service and life safety data and applications that were lost, those were the critical things we really tried to focus on. Some of those examples that are in this report include the EMS patient care reports that we lost. We were, as Chuck, I think, indicated at the budget hearing, we were able to get back a lot of those, but not all of them. And those are critical pieces of information for billing and just patient care in general. CECOM also, that was a large impact. Had to resort to their card system instead of being able to use the data on the CAD right in front of the telecommunicator to dispatch medical and fire calls. Obviously, with the Sheriff's Department losing the ability to log in their cars, that's a pretty significant impact to the deputies. And then DSS too. DSS lost scanned documents from Monday, which they see numerous clients every day, and they're creating case files and getting proof of residency and income, and all of those things were lost, as well as child and adult protective call information. So on Monday there were calls coming in to DSS to report, child protective issues or adult protective issues. A lot of that data was lost too. So this was we lost information that was critical to life safety and emergency services. What have we done since? We have done a number of things. One of the first things that we did may seem simple, but was quite important, was to adopt policies for the department that will dictate from now on how updates will be conducted, when, how communications will work, what to do in the event of another incident like this, because these things will happen. This was a hardware kind of issue, and in the IT world, we will have something like this happen again. So we want to make sure that we're as prepared as we can be. Since this incident, we've also began replacing our backup software with a new version, a new model called Alamance, that will enable us to do quicker system backups. So it will be real time, which is the ideal. That's where you would like to be. This is not real time, but it is faster than the current system that we have. It also only saves new data. So whereas the old system is backing up everything constantly, the Alamance system will save what has been created. It'll really target the new stuff. It'll still keep the old, but it's not having to recreate everything every time. And the Alamance system will save more often than the current system that we have. We've also worked with Davenport and NWN, who are two consulting firms. They've worked with MIS to make improvements to the county network that will aid us in making sure the existing network is more efficient, is more secure, and is also more sustainable. Network needed to be mapped so employees understood how it's configured, so there can be some continuity. If people come and go, we need to be able to make sure that we know how that system works and we understand it. The next steps, and I'm going through this rather quickly, but you know, at the end of this, if you have questions, I'll certainly try to answer. What we've put in the MIS department's budget, we talked about this at the budget meeting, we're recommending that the county implement a redundant data center. This would be a real-time backup for data, and also these applications like NetMotion and some of the things that we lost. It would be localized. So the redundant data center, you have data that is currently being stored in applications that are running in this building. It would also take place at the HSC building. We would upfit that with a similar system. It would be two systems running, saving data, making sure applications ran. If one went down, we would jump over to the other side. And we would use the existing fiber connection. There's a fiber connection that runs from this building over to HSC currently. And we would make use of that to run this redundant data center. Well, we're estimating that cost to be approximately $230,000. That request is in the MIS department's budget. It may be possible to replace some of that cost by leasing some of those hardware components rather than buying. We are looking into that. So it may not be an entire $230,000. And of course, we would use 911 monies or any other appropriate funds that we can to offset those costs. We believe that that is possible. And we're looking into that now to figure out if we lease, can we apply to the state to get some funding from 911, because this will benefit the 911 center. And we talked a lot about a cloud solution, about an off-site. That really does need to be part of our overall solution. We think the first step is to get it locally redundant. Then have eventually have a hybrid system where we're also using the cloud for what is appropriate. We have some systems in the county that are legacy systems. They're emergency service type systems that are intricate and are not dated but stayed, I guess I would say. We also hold a lot of data that is confidential and requires some of the highest security level. We can do that with a redundant data center. We believe we can do that to some level with the cloud. I don't feel comfortable recommending to you right now the cloud be a part of our backup system, but I do think that is going to be a part of what we'll be bringing to you eventually. We're also, besides the redundant data center, we're recommending the county institute a second internet circuit. One thing we found as we met with county departments and talked with them about what they lost, what happened during the crash, a lot of people weren't affected. But the reason they weren't affected was because they're using web-based applications. We currently have one internet circuit for all of county government. We recommend the county consider funding a second circuit that would be a standby, because if we were to lose internet connection for a long period of time, many of our web-based applications would go down. These would include things like NC Fast with DSS, Health's new electronic medical record system that's coming, WIC, operations at the library, the Board of Elections, Veteran Services, a lot of systems running on the web. We're included in MIS's budget for next year, $18,000 that would add an additional circuit. That is an annual fee, but it would be in place in the event the one we have goes out. Also, we're recommending in the next year's MIS budget a second fiber leg be run between these two buildings. We think we can work with the city of Burlington to defray some of those costs from the original leg that was run, but we're recommending $75,000 in MIS's budget for this project. Currently, we have one fiber cable connecting the two departments, which in the event of if we had a storm, car crash, anything could take that out. We feel more comfortable if there were two. And again, this would be another project that we would try to offset with 911 money or any other appropriate funding. And the final piece I would mention to you that we should consider for MIS is additional training for their staff. I'll talk about this again at the budget. I'm sorry, this is a little repetitive. But the MIS staff currently, the current proposed budget was for $5,000 for 20 full-time employees in MIS to be trained. As you folks know, the IT world changes constantly. That's not adequate. And it does have a bearing on security, and it does have a bearing on operability. These folks are the ones that maintain our networks, keep them secure, keep our databases up. It is important to keep them trained on what happens today. They get a lot of push-outs from Microsoft and all these things that they have to deal with. And I feel like that would be a benefit from a security standpoint, too. So try to go through this quickly, because I know you've had it. I didn't want to read it to you. But I would certainly try to field any questions. I want to thank MIS staff. This has been a difficult process to work through for county departments as well as for MIS. But it's also an opportunity, frankly, for us to take a hard look at ourselves, our department, how we're set up. And we feel that these recommendations we're bringing you, I know they're expensive, but the data that the county is holding and the functions that we're providing, particularly in emergency service and life safety, are just so critical. We felt like it is justifiable to bring it to your attention. So I'll try to answer any questions you may have.
Let me say, I didn't understand a word that Brian said there. But I do know that senior management did an outstanding job tracking down everything that happened. And I congratulate you, Mr. Manager, and Mr. Assistant Manager, for doing such a good job.
But the city of Burlington, have you talked with them any? I mean, how do they work their off-site, on-site storage? Because they run a lot of the same things. You got a police department, fire department, a lot of things that are running through theirs. And
I personally am not familiar with their system. I know that our MIS people interact with them regularly.
Right.
I think if we go this route, we would want to talk with them and our other municipalities here too about either the possibility of them partnering with us, because if we create a redundant data center here, it may be something if they don't have, they may want to take advantage of and team up with us. I want to say that up to 3 months ago, I was not nearly as up to speed on this information as I am now, and I'm only the tip of the iceberg, to be honest.
Yeah.
So it has been a lot for me to learn. We do have good folks in the MIS department, and I think it would be wise to reach out to the cities and bring them in.
I think it would be, too, because, you know, you hate to be duplicating things where maybe they could take advantage of and help defray some of the costs.
Yes.
And work with us to come up with a better solution for everybody.
And, you know, we share some operability with them now, with a number of them, through things like our tax collection, through our GIS services. You know, they rely on the county to provide that for them. Some, I think, for example, the city of Burlington, they edit some of our data, because particularly GIS. So we're already sharing some operability there. So that would be a definite first step.
I would like to see you at least have a conversation. I don't know where you go with it, but
that's something we might bring up when we have our meeting with the city council.
Do we now have written policy?
We do have written policy.
Updates, and
they're included in your report also, the last page, but yes, sir.
Okay. We're also working on more written policies now as we move forward. And I do want to appreciate the work that Brian has done on this, and also our MIS staff, and also our liaisons, because we have large data users at the Sheriff's Department. We have a computer liaison at the library. We have a computer liaison with DSS and the Health Department. So, again, a lot of people have worked on this, and a lot of people have gotten us to this point. The most exciting thing, really, about this is now we are moving forward, and I'm really excited about the direction, and we're addressing some things, and sometimes you really don't know there is a problem until you have an outage like we had.
Yeah.
But as Brian also said, it's going to happen again, and we feel like we're be able to address those outages much better from this point on than we have in the past. So this is really a good opportunity for our MIS staff, and also for everybody as far as using our data.
And the key is the backup.
Yes, sir.
As we all know, and when you look at just the different ramifications from a public safety concept, from a statutory concept, and from a public records concept, from a privacy concept, from a fiduciary concept, all these things that you've mentioned in your report, and I mean, this was nothing that was a small matter, and as the judge said, I appreciate management getting on this and doing a detailed investigation and report to us.
And the leasing of equipment, I think, if that's an option. To me personally, with computer equipment and storage and all that, it's like what's relevant today, tomorrow's not. So,
absolutely.
And looking at buying equipment a lot of time is not really prudent, I don't think.
I agree. So, there's no action, just to present it to you, bring to your attention.
Thank you. Thank you.
Very good.
Thank you.
All right, next we have budget amendments. The Health Department, Ms. Saunders.
Good evening.
Good evening.
So I am presenting to you all today the budget amendment for environmental health. The Health Department was allocated $36,977 from the North Carolina Division of Public Health for our food and lodging and institution inspections, programs, and activities. The environmental health section has performed over 2,000 inspections in the last year and has achieved over 100% or at 100% compliance with their mandatory inspection requirements. And as you can see here, what they want to spend that money on are supplies, particularly computer supplies for their GIS software, computer cases and the warranties for those, some medical and scientific supplies and small tools that they use in the inspections, like the light meters and the thermometers in the restaurants, trainings, communications, and the two largest amounts are for capital outlay, the almost $7,000 for the GIS unit that they use, and vehicles, one vehicle.
Thank you.
I'll move to approve.
We have a motion. We have a second.
I'll second it.
Second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you
so much.
Appreciate it. Next, we have item 9, financial update. Ms. Roberts.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening.
Hope everyone is doing well. I'm here tonight to present our 9-month financial update. As you can see from our adopted budget, and this will wreak havoc in the same format as I did the 6-month, so we're just going to hit the high spots. But for our amended budget, we are now at $134 million, which is a 2.63% change as to where we were with the adopted budget of $1,030,000. Okay. Revenues are percentage collected and compared to where we were at this time, fiscal year 13-14, are running the same at 82%. Our category increases percentage overall, we are up 2%. Sales tax continues to come in higher than anticipated, and that's the trend across the state right now, so we're averaging about 12% change there. Other taxes and license are 8%. Intergovernmental funds, which is our federal and state funding, is up 17%. Sales and services is up 1%. License and permits are slightly down at 3%. And our investment earnings are up 138%. Expenditures, we are very comparable to where we were at this time last fiscal year. We have expended 71% of our budget versus 72% of last year. And our revenues over expenses, we are at $10,372,690. And other financing sources, you can see we're at the positive of 3.9. Are there any questions?
These numbers are through March 31st?
Correct.
So if we've spent 71%, then we're three-fourths of the way through the budget, mm-hmm. so we're...
Right on target, where we need to be.
Sales tax being up is helping the numbers. Is that
exactly
where that's coming
from? Right. Any further questions? Thank you.
All right, thank you.
All right, County Manager's report.
I do have a few things tonight. First, we do have another wonderful video from the North Carolina County Commissioners Association, so that you will have a legislative update. So, all right.
Hello and welcome to the April 2015 County Update video from the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners. In today's video, we'll introduce you to the 2015 NCACC Annual Conference keynote speaker. We'll tell you about the NCACC's premier grassroots advocacy event, the 2015 County Assembly Day. We'll discuss National County Government Month, and we'll tell you how NCACC Risk Management is providing a higher level of services without an increase in rates for members around the state. So let's start with the 2015 Annual Conference. The keynote speaker at the conference hosts the Start With Why podcast that is downloaded in nearly 130 countries, and he is an international speaker and consultant. He believes that every person deserves to wake up inspired to go to work and to come home at the end of the day fulfilled by the work they do. David Mead works with leaders to help them create an environment where people show up to work because they want to, not because they have to. An environment in which people are inspired to contribute to something bigger than themselves. His presentation contains five principles that, when combined together, can bring an environment of engagement, innovation, and breakthrough. Mead will address attendees at the opening general session of conference on Friday, August 21st. Keep an eye out in County Lines, the association's news publication, and on www.ncacc.org for more announcements about the 2015 annual conference, including other speakers, educational sessions, and the conference theme, which will be announced soon. The NCACC will host its 2015 County Assembly Day on Wednesday, May 6, 2015, at the Quorum Center in Raleigh. County Assembly Day is an important part of the county advocacy efforts of the association. The event provides an opportunity for North Carolina county officials like you to meet with and hear from state legislative leaders and to meet with their state legislative representatives in Raleigh. The event begins in the morning with a legislative update from the NCACC staff and remarks from leaders of the General Assembly. After lunch, attendees visit the North Carolina General Assembly to meet with members of their delegation to discuss specific county issues that are currently percolating in the legislature. County officials will be provided handouts and information about these issues that they can share with their legislative members. To encourage participation by elected officials, the association has waived the pre-registration fee for county commissioners who sign up before April 24th. All others must pay the pre-registration fee. After April 24th, county commissioners and staff must register on-site and pay the on-site registration fee. Online registration is available through the NCACC website by visiting www.ncacc.org/countyassemblyday. During the months of March and April, the NCACC is holding its yearly series of district meetings. This year, there are six meetings held as far west as Jackson County and as far east as Onslow County. The meetings are designed to be both an update on advocacy issues for attendees and an opportunity for the NCACC to hear feedback from counties about meetings or interactions they've had with their own legislative delegation. Each year we publish a map like this one on our website highlighting which counties have planned and held meetings with their legislators. Each year we send out a packet of meeting materials that highlight the key issues for counties. This year, as usual, we've had great participation from counties, but we always strive to improve and would love to see this entire map filled every year. Also remember, to stay on top of legislative issues affecting county government, you can subscribe to our legislative bulletin by visiting www.ncacc.org/legislative-bulletin. Or you can watch our Made for Government television program this week at the General Assembly. Both are produced each week. The General Assembly is in session. April is a busy time of year for counties, as it is for us here at the Association. Let's not forget, though, that April is National County Government Month. It's the month each year where we spend a little extra effort to let the public know what county government does for its citizens. We'd love to know what your county is doing this year. So please send us any write-ups and photos of events you may be holding during the month of April to our communications staff at communications@ncacc.org. Finally, let's talk about risk management and the two projects they recently completed. The Human Resources Legal Helpline came online for risk management pool members on January 1st of this year and provides limited access to attorneys with strong experience in employment law. the line comes at no additional cost to pool members. The second project, now up and running, is the development and rollout of a cyber liability risk control web portal for pool members. It provides access to sample cyber-related best practice policies and other related risk control tools, such as contractual language for outside vendors providing IT service. More information on both of these new services is available by visiting the Risk Management tab at the NCACC website. The NCACC Governmental Risk Pools Board of Trustees met in March and reviewed the projections for the year, including membership participation levels. Based on those projections, the board decided there would be no increases in workers' compensation or property casualty base rates for the coming year. This marks the fourth consecutive year both risk pools have been able to avoid an increase in rates while maintaining a 100% county membership retention. Both risk pools have grown by one or two new county members each year with steady, continued financial growth, generating currently the best financial position for both pools in over a decade. Well, that's all we have for this month's report. If you would like to get more information on any of the items we discussed here, please visit www.ncacc.org. Or you can email us at communications@ncacc.org. We're always happy to hear from our member counties. Thank you for watching. We'll see you next month.
I know you will be waiting for breathless anticipation for next month, so we'll have it again next month.
Need another update.
I do have a couple of things. I do want to remind you, we do have two additional budget workshops this week on Wednesday and Thursday afternoon, and those are with our outside agencies beginning at 1:30. So if anybody has any questions about that. Also, with respect to our pain classification study, we are meeting with staff, with the consultant tomorrow to kind of finalize a recommendation to begin bring it back to the board. So we'll hopefully have that as a meeting. It'll probably take a while to go through everything, so we'll probably be doing that in the first week in May. We'd be asking for another afternoon workshop on that, just specifically dealing with the pain class study. But we'll get you a time and place once we get a little further down the road. The next we want to bring in to you is an update on the county line issue. And is Jeremy here? Jeremy Aikens, our tax administrator, and Bruce Walker, who's our GIS and also our interim MIS director, did an absolutely fabulous job in trying to make a very complicated issue very simple. And the question that came up was, with respect to the county line, was how much revenue was being lost by Guilford County. And they said $8 million of not revenue, but valuation was being lost. And Jeremy, if I'm saying this wrong, please correct me. If we do the compromise line, they will gain $8 million in valuation. We will gain $2 million in valuation. So it's a swap. They really come up $6 million to the good. If they go geodetic, they will gain $14 million in property valuation.
If you think of it as a net amount, right now, the difference between the geodetic survey and the compromise is the difference for Guilford between 6 and 14, and for us between 6 and 14. If we went geodetic survey line, then we would stand to lose 6. They would stand to gain 6. If we do compromise, then we'll actually be, I'm sorry, we would stand to lose the 14. Then we lose 6 under compromise, which is an improvement for us. Still a loss of value. They would go from having gained 14 under a geodetic survey to only gaining 6. So really, the number quoted of about $8 million is accurate, but it's not an $8 million loss. It's $8 million less gain.
So what does that equate to in tax revenue?
Well, for us, it's about $40,000, which, if you look at $8 million difference out of a $10 billion real estate valuation is less than a tenth of a percent. I imagine theirs is pretty similar.
Well, where's our resolution on that in the General Assembly? You know,
we have
sent to Dennis last week.
Sent that to Dennis, and basically we've asked him to refile the 2013 compromise bill that we did originally.
So it's wait and see now, right?
And that may not be this year. I think that the deadline, I think they've passed the deadline, so it would have to be next May, I guess, or maybe in the short session, maybe. Maybe. Local bills, I think.
We'll just keep collecting that money as long as we can.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Any further?
I do have a couple of additional things. A couple of meeting dates to mention to you. Wednesday, May 6th at 9:30 at the Family Justice Center is the next school facilities joint committee meeting. So that'll be May 6th. Also, we talked about a little bit earlier, is we've been trying to set a joint meeting with Burlington City Council, talk a lot of different issues, animal control, telecommunications, IT, you name it. We've got economic development. There's a lot of joint issues.
Transportation.
I knew Commissioner Byrd would not let me forget transportation. But a lot of different issues that we need to just have some open dialogue with them and kind of share information about. Right now we have that scheduled for May 11th at 6 p.m. Also at the Family Justice Center. And a couple other things with respect to the Ngabi Trust request. I've talked a couple of times to the gentleman from Davidson County, and we're waiting on their signed person to get back with us. So it is coming. We're just trying to coordinate when is a good time for them and their signed installer. So. One other thing I do want to mention publicly, this was a special announcement we got. It's an email this week, and I'm just going to read the email. Public announcement, Susan Osborne has been selected to receive the Karen Ponder Award this year at the National Smart Start Conference. This award recognizes excellence through outstanding service to the children and families in North Carolina. This is a wonderful recognition for our county. And though everyone agrees, Susan deserves it. I believe that this is the first time a DSS director has won this, and I think it speaks to the level of collaboration that we have in our county. So I just wanted to recognize Susan.
Thank you. 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 Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank
you.
Thank
you.
Thank
you.
Thank
you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
May 18th.
Getting closer.
Yeah. It's getting nitty gritty.
All right. No further from our county manager. Commissioner's comments.
Well, one thing that, Greg, maybe you can help check on this is I understood that the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners was working on a database of comparable information from one county to the next. That would be really useful as we go through the budget so we can kind of get a handle on, well, how do we compare, name any department with respect to our expenditure per population or whatever benchmarks would be appropriate.
We can, they do have that information. We can get that for you.
And I thought that they had it for some areas, but they hadn't worked it out for all areas yet. But if we can get some of that, that would be really helpful for me.
I want to personally thank Susan over there for going to my Kiwanis and speaking to them to enlighten them about the budget. And
you're very welcome.
As they said, the public needs to know, and she does a great job. So anybody has a civic group, I'm sure she'd be glad to do that after the budget's over.
Well, I'll say that two people came up to me who were at that meeting and gave rave reviews.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
Good, you gave it. A couple things. First, I'd like to just thank staff and our department heads on their budget presentations in a timely manner. Great job. And, you know, it's important, and the local media did a good job reporting, and thank you for that also. It's just so important that the general public, they have the opportunity to see, you know, where the funding goes. It's just so important. So it gave them the opportunity to see that, but you guys did a great job and also in holding down, you know, what your requests were. Thank you for that also, and we'll do the best we can. And the second thing is I have a resolution before me that came to my attention, and I didn't get a chance to get it on our agenda for the night, but it's from the CCA, and it's in reference to the summer flounder. And the summer flounder's in great distress right now on our coast in North Carolina, to the point that the powers to be have extended the season into November and December, which is at a time when the breeding stock's coming out of the tributaries going back into the ocean, you know, so they can get ready to make little babies again. And and so how bad? Well, it's, I think it's, what, maybe 2% now? I got a couple of gentlemen here I'm pointing to this.
Who's your speaker?
Sammy, or
maybe get come on up. Enlightenment's a little
yes,
bit
sir.
On that.
Well, we have 10,653 people in Alamance County out of 800, over 800,000 that do fish at the coast.
Yeah.
And they come through here, and the vast majority of them are headed to the coast to fish for flounder.
Yeah.
The southern flounder is a fish that is basically goes from Florida to North Carolina.
Yeah.
The vast majority of them are born in North Carolina, and they live here until they're about 2 to 3 years old, and then they go out of the inlets to breed, and a lot of times they don't come back here. They go on down south, but some of them do come back here. For 23 years, this fish has been classified as overfished, and for 23 years, the MFC has, in their wisdom, has elected not to protect the fish in any way or reduce the harvest of it.
It's marine fisheries.
And that's the marine fisheries, and it's gotten so bad that they've finally have gotten enough pressure on them that they went to the Secretary of Diener of Natural Resources, Energy and Natural Resources. He's asked for a supplement. We don't know what is going to be in that supplement until the May meeting, but a lot of counties that are have tourist dollars that flow through their area and have a lot of local fishermen are passing this resolution. It was passed in Lenoir County just this evening. I just got a text while I was sitting here. To ask the MFC to do whatever they possibly can to support this supplement. The credentials of the supplement or the criteria of the supplement are going to come down in the May meeting. There'll be a 30-day public comment period. And then in the August meeting, they will decide on what they're going to do. The main harvest that we're trying to protect is from September the 15th to December the 15th. As many as 20 years ago, the people that managed the fish management plan asked for a November 8th closing. And the MFC has never had a closing less than December the 1st. And in some years, they close it on December 31st and reopen it on January 1st the next year. So,
this is Mr. Bud Abbott, for the record.
I'm local here.
Yes.
I've been the president of CCA in Piedmont chapter for 10 years, and I'm now state president for North Carolina. And we would appreciate it if y'all would go with the other counties and endorse the resolution that we put before you. Because like I say, there's people that drive from Asheville to go flounder fishing every year. And they come through here, buy gas, stay at a restaurant, stay at our motels, and some of them buy tackle here. You know, and that's what we're trying to do.
Thank you, Bud.
Thank you.
So this resolution goes to the North Carolina Marine Fishery Commission.
Yes, it is a resolution to them, and it will be presented not only by Alamance County, if y'all pass it, but by a lot of counties. We're not going to get it from Dare County or Hyde County where the commercial fishermen are, but we will get it from a lot of counties.
I know Wake and Wayne's looking at it right now.
Wake,
they had
Wayne.
The Lord passed it earlier tonight, earlier today. And, so if I have a by consensus, I will sign this. And
I move that we do it on a consensus.
All right. Thank you. Judge, you okay with it?
Yeah.
All right.
I'm okay with that.
Thank you. Any other comments from commissioners? If not, meeting's adjourned. Thank you. I missed 2 minutes.
You did.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m., and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.